The soccer turf war continues and now possible legal action. Yesterday's U.S. women's national soccer team match against Trinidad and Tobago was canceled because of turf concerns at Aloha Stadium. The U.S. team took their first steps on the turf on Saturday, just hours before boycotting the match. They said they weren't pleased with the terrain, scene placement, and stadium dimensions. Gina Mangieri is always investigating. She was the first to uncover the U.S. Soccer Federation is now getting lawyers involved. Gina.
Marissa, the stadium authority says it's become a legal issue after they were contacted today by U.S. Soccer's attorney instigating a legal action. I obtained that letter from U.S. Soccer and all of its contracts between state entities to dig deeper about what's going on. It's a turf war on several fronts. On one side, has the state dodged a bullet over a technicality? At least the Hawaii Tourism Authority thinks so. The state's tourism office made a deal to pay U.S. Soccer $200,000 in the form of a game promotion agreement. Half of it due before the event was even to have taken place. But HTA told KHON2 today none of the sponsorship funds have been paid out, as HTA has never received an original, fully executed and notarized signed contract from the U.S. Soccer Federation. But that's not the only deal dealing with this game. There was a separate contract to use the stadium itself. Always Investigating uncovered that U.S. Soccer would have played rent-free. They were also going to keep all ticket revenue and all money from broadcast and photo rights. The stadium's only upside was food and beverage sales and parking fees. I've obtained a signed copy of the stadium agreement between the state and U.S. Soccer, and it says that U.S. Soccer agreed to accept the stadium in the condition that it exists unless the stadium authority had taken steps to actively conceal defects in the stadium. We wanted a closer look at the field today, but the stadium authority said they couldn't let us in, even to the sidelines, because they say it's become a legal issue. That's because they got slapped with a letter from the U.S. Soccer Federation's attorney. So I took a closer look at the contract. U.S. Soccer acknowledged the field was slightly smaller than soccer's usual requirements. The stadium had to deliver no alterations other than removing residual markings from other sports. And it gave U.S. Soccer the right to inspect the field 7 days ahead and again 48 hours prior to the game. Things looked good at that time.
When they signed the contract and they came on a Thursday, they made it very clear that it was acceptable. Nothing came up until last night at the last hour.
But the contract does require a, quote, first-class field. And it's on those grounds that U.S. Soccer now seems to intend to hold the state in default, despite the stadium saying soccer accepted the field days earlier. In a letter the state received today, U.S. Soccer's general counsel accuses the stadium authority of delivering a field unfit, unsafe, and unplayable, calling that an uncured default by the stadium authority and reserving their rights and remedies. This despite the contract stating U.S. Soccer will not make any claim against the state for losses. Now, the state attorney general's office had no further comment because they're still reviewing that letter. Sources told me that low ticket sales weighed in on the decision to cancel. The stadium authority's meeting minutes from earlier in the fall revealed that U.S. Soccer expected 25 to 30,000 tickets to be sold, but only 16,000 were. Neither U.S. Soccer nor the player's attorney has responded to requests for comment on any of these matters. Gina Mangieri, KHON2 News.